And point of time, I know he's extremely busy because West Bengal had one of the biggest ever human evacuation possible before a cyclone, about 1.5 million. And we really would like to hear from Javed Saab how they could do it and how they are planning to combat in future. Welcome, Javed Saab, to the show. Welcome.
Hello. Nice meeting.
We have with me Dr. KJ Ramesh. Dr. Ramesh is the person who will be talking to us why the cyclones are coming so frequently. Dr. Ramesh is the former and is the person who needs to talk about these issues. Welcome, Dr. Ramesh, to the show.
Thank you.
I have with me Aditi Kapoor. Aditi works on the livelihood, gender, development in context of climate change. She is the founder member of Alternative Future and also being attached to Red Cross. And really the relief and this rehabilitation and entire thing, we really, really would like to hear from Aditi. Aditi, welcome to the show.
Hello, everyone, and thank you so much for having me here.
Great, great to have you. And I have with me Mohammed Samsud Doha. We call him Doha Bhai from CPRO Bangladesh and works on these agendas and issues for quite some time. And as I was saying before we went on the formal recording, that West Bengal and Bangladesh share so many things. We share Hilsa, we share so many things, and we also share the cyclones. So your experience is very, very important because we all know that Bangladesh is having a very good disaster management system. So how you are planning to cope in Bangladesh is something we should know about it. And finally, I have somebody from the ground. I have Taposh Mundal. Taposh is the chief organizer from the Jono Sromoji Vishongo, a local organization from Sundarbans. At this point of time, he is in Goshaba Island, Goshaba Block, Kumirmari Island, which is one of the hardest hit by the cyclone Yaas, and we really, really would like to know from Tapash how is the ground situation out there. So that's the panel for us, and with the permission of all of you, let me first go to Tapash. Let us hear from the ground what's happening, then we can start discussing. Tapash Babu, abhi Bangla-tei bolun for the all of you. Tapash would like to talk in Bengali language. Few of you may not be understanding it. I will try to translate it as far as possible. Tapash Babu, please let us know that what is the ground reality? Ki obostha okhane royeche ei muhurte Kumilmari Sundorboner obostha ta ki? Bolun. Apni mute kore achen Tapash Babu, ami unmute korbo.
Thank you, Jayantudan. Thank you, everybody. Jo ami ekhon Kumilmari Island ei achi. মাননীয় মন্ত্রী সাহেবও আছেন আমাদের এই যে সিচুয়েশন রিয়েল সিচুয়েশন যেটা হচ্ছে সেটা মোটামুটি আমাদের যখন জশটা এখানে আছড়ে পড়ে সে সময় বেশিরভাগ জায়গায় যেটা হয় নদী বাঁধ খুব ছোট এবং এ থাকার জন্যে ভঙ্গুর থাকার জন্য অনেকটা জায়গায় নদীর বাঁধের উপর থেকে জল উপচে পড়তে শুরু করে বেশিরভাগ জায়গায় জল উপচে পড়ে এবং বেশ কিছু জায়গায় নদী ভাঙন ভয়ঙ্কর ভাবে ভাঙতে শুরু করে ছোট প্রথমে অল্প অল্প তারপরে দিনের পর দিন সেটা বাড়তে বাড়তে বহু জায়গায় চলে যায় ইনক্লুডিং আমি বাংলাদেশের পার্ট থেকে যদি ধরি হিঙ্গলগঞ্জ ব্লক আমাদের তারপরে গোসাবা ব্লক সেখান থেকে যদি আমি আমাদের বাসন্তী ব্লক থেকে ক্যানিং টু ব্লক সেখান থেকে কুলতলি জয়নগর নামখানা পাত্রপুদিমা প্রত্যেকটা জায়গাতে এইভাবে নদী বাঁধ ভঙ্গুর থাকার জন্য জল ঢুকে গেছে আমি যে একদম যশের অনেকদিন আগে থেকে এই অঞ্চলে ছিলাম সেখানে কুমিরমারি গোসাবা ব্লকের সবচেয়ে ড্যামেজ জায়গা যেখানে এখনো পর্যন্ত জল ঢুকছে এখনো লোকজন মাঠের কাছাকাছি এসে রয়েছে যে এটা এইটা যে জায়গা থেকে জলটা বেশিরভাগ জায়গায় ঢুকছে সেটা হচ্ছে যে একদম যে আমাদের যে মরিচঝাপি জঙ্গল মরিচঝাপির ঠিক উল্টো দিকে যে অংশটা কুমিরমারির সেখানে প্রায় 1 কিলোমিটারের মতো রাস্তা নেই প্রায় মানে কম বেশি করে ভেঙে চলে গেছে যেটা এখনো বাঁধার শুরু করা যায়নি মানে অল্প বিস্তর শুরু করা গেছে জল এখনো ঢুকছে এখনো পর্যন্ত আমাদের এই জায়গা পর্যন্ত চলে এসছে মানে এখান থেকে ধরা যায় টোটাল কুমিরমারি 18,000 বিঘা জমি আছে তার মধ্যে প্রায় 12,000 বিঘা জমির মতো অলরেডি জলের তলায় কম বেশি জলের তলায় যেটা আগামী দিনে চাষ করা সম্ভব প্রায় নয় এবং তারপরে যেটা হয়েছে যে লোকাল যে মাছ যেগুলো ছিল যেগুলো আমাদের মিষ্টি জলের মাছ সেগুলো ভয়ঙ্কর ভাবে নষ্ট হয়ে গেছে লোকজন এখনো পর্যন্ত নৌকার উপরে থাকছে রাস্তার উপরে থাকছে তাদের খাবার দাবার নেই তারা আমি কি ওয়েট করবো আপনি কি ট্রান্সলেট করবেন
শুনতে পাচ্ছি বলুন
তাদের খাবার দাবার নেই এবং তাদের এই মুহূর্তে যেটা প্রয়োজন যে ইমিডিয়েট সবাই যেটা চাইছে যেটা আমাদের সঙ্গে বারবার বলছে আমরা যখন ফিল্ড ভিজিটে যাচ্ছি তখন বলছে কিভাবে নদী বাঁধ বাঁধা যায় ঠিক করে বাঁধা যায় সেটা স্যার আপনারা দেখুন মানে এটা আমরা অবশ্যই চেষ্টা করবো অ্যাডভোকেসি করতে কথাবার্তা বলতে অর্গানাইজেশনের সঙ্গে কথা বলতে গভর্নমেন্টের সঙ্গে কথা বলতে যেটা আমাদের কাজ নয় কিন্তু আমরা বলতে পারি চেষ্টা করতে পারি এটা মাননীয় মন্ত্রী সাহেব আছেন উনি একবার দেখতেই পারেন বিষয়টা এটা আমাদের গ্রাউন্ড জায়গা থেকে
জানতে চেয়েছেন যে এটা কি অবস্থায় রয়েছে এবং আমরা শুনলাম তাপস বাবু আপনি একটু মিউট করতে পারেন কারণ আপনার ওখান থেকে আওয়াজ আসছে অনেকটা সো লেট মি ভেরি ভেরি ব্রিফলি ট্রান্সলেট হোয়াট তাপস হ্যাজ জাস্ট শেয়ার উইথ আস হোয়াট ইজ সেইং দ্যাট হি ইজ ইন কুমিরমারি দ্যাটস অ্যান আইল্যান্ড ইউ নো দ্যাট সুন্দরবন ইজ হ্যাভিং অ্যাবাউট 102 আইল্যান্ডস আউট অফ 102 আইল্যান্ডস 54 আইল্যান্ডস আর হিউম্যান হ্যাবিটেশনস অ্যান্ড 48 আর ওয়াইল্ড আইল্যান্ডস সো ডিভাস্টেশনস দিস টাইম ইজ মোর অন দ্য ওয়েস্টার্ন পার্ট অফ সুন্দরবন অ্যান্ড অলসো দ্য সেন্ট্রাল পার্ট হোয়ার তাপস ইজ রাইট নাও What is saying that after the 26th, with that high tide and as well as the kind of landfall coinciding, so the lot of flood water and lot of embankments have been overtopped. Not only the embankments have been breached, they have been overtopped. And in Kumilmari itself, 2/3 of Kumilmari is underwater. And I know from other sources that Ghoramara Island, a small island, 50% people had to leave Ghoramara because of the situation. So mainly the agenda and the issue is of this river bank, the embankments. The embankments are the kind of a tricky situation and they need to be taken care of. So that is the situation. The people in Sundarban, many people in Sundarban, despite government's best efforts, are still underwater. People are living on boat. People are living on road because their houses have been completely damaged. As Honorable Chief Minister said sometime back, that many have... I think houses have been, about 3 lakh houses have been damaged. So that's the situation that Tapash shared with us. And that actually drive home the reality on ground. So with that, let me go to our Honorable Minister Javed Sir first. Javed Sir, we know that Yaas has been a huge disaster because the high tide overlapped with that. Now, you have been evacuated almost 15 lakh people. So please share with us that what is the government plan and government thinking right now about countering Yas and its impact?
Yes, thank you very much. I have heard about it from the ground level now, Mr. Tapas Mundra. Definitely, the government is working on it very with all its sincerity and efforts. And we have already, you know, before the ash landed, landfall, we have removed around or evacuated around 50, more than 15 lakh people from the embankments and coastal area. That was a huge task, and we have did it. We have done it, and now the rehabilitation and what we call reconstruction work has to be undertaken. It is being taken, but relief is being given by the district administration everywhere. We have already 15,215 relief camps opened already for the people, distressed people. They are being kept there. They have been feeding. We are feeding them there. We have been providing medical aid to them. But reconstruction of house will take a little more time, and reconstruction of the barns, what we call the dams and barns, will take a little more time because water has to recede. It has to go down. Otherwise, it cannot be taken. We are trying our best, and already disaster management along with other departments, the IT department is working on it. Around 3 lakhs government staff, semi and direct staff are engaged with the rehabilitation and reconstruction work now.
Okay. We should congratulate you, Jagat Saab, because despite such a huge disaster, I think only 1% died in West Bengal. I think only one. Isn't it, Jagat Saab? Only 1% died.
1%, I will not yet not confirm, but we have received some reports that some people died due to drowning, some people died due to electrocution and all that. But directly, one people died of the ash.
So that's a very minimum number. So I think that's a very, very, very some achievement on government parts that you could actually manage or you could minimize the death. So that is the most important definitely. Thing that you could do.
Yeah, definitely. Our chief minister was very keen from the very first day when we got the report that Yash is going to come in a very big way. It has got a very huge, it will take a huge loss of life and property. So we were anticipating it, and with that we had started the evacuation work, and we had already deployed our men and materials everywhere around the coastal belt of Mednapur, Diga, and then 2 to 24 partners. We have also got our men stationed everywhere. And DRF was there, SDRF was there, the police was there, civil defense volunteer was there, the local administration was there. They were working overnight. And we could, we have managed the casualties, but you know, we cannot fight nature.
Exactly.
We cannot fight nature. That is the problem. And now around more than 3 lakh houses have been damaged. Our chief minister has, yesterday she visited, made an area survey. She was there in the control room the whole night on the 26th itself, 25th itself, and the 26th, she was the whole day. She had meeting with all the officers ground level, and she rushed materials and relief everywhere. And she was monitoring herself. This was the whatever importance given or priority given to Yash to for the evacuation and rehabilitation work we have given, and our efforts are there to make the suffering more easy.
Thank you, Jabez Saab. I'll come back to you to talk about that. Okay, we have saved lives, but what about the livelihoods? Now that's the bigger challenge. Lives are saved, that's the first priority, but now the livelihoods. We'll be coming to that. But let me first go to Dr. Ramesh. Dr. Ramesh, this whole credit of kind of stopping the lives being lost is with the IMD, because IMD's now prediction system seems wonderful. A scientist was telling me now IMD is even predicting before the actual storm or the cyclone starts to kind of generate. So how you see this? This whole the series of cyclones are coming one after another. Is it a new trend? Is it a new normal?
Yes, very much, Jayant. You know that global warming, atmosphere is warming. Almost it has crossed almost 1.1 degree centigrade warming from pre-industrial era of 1850 or so. But oceans were not warming with that accelerated speed. Now, last 10 decades or so, oceans are warming in an accelerated manner. Compared to 1.1 degree of atmospheric warming, oceans, at least by Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, have warmed almost 0.7 degrees warming. So it is quite a significant warming. So oceans, that's how have a lot of energy and a lot of heat to transfer to the circulation system, cyclonic circulation, low pressure, etc., whenever it forms. So ocean is always ready for atmospheric anomaly to be formed and favorably allow it to grow in an accelerated manner. You see, ocean is playing a very significant role because of warming reaching about 0.7 degrees. That is a very high increase. And ours is a narrow basin. Bay of Bengal is... open only one side, other sides it is covered by continent, and such a warm conditions, and then whenever a system forms and atmosphere becomes conducive, so in 2 days it becomes from low pressure to very severe and extremely severe cyclonic storm.
So you expect more such cyclones to come more frequently?
Yes. At least principal rain cyclone season is April, May and October to November. Those 4 months, I think we have to be ready for to deal.
We have to be ready for countering cyclones.
Back-to-back cyclones we have seen now. There could be simultaneous cyclones also. One over Bay of Bengal, one over Arabian Sea. So that scenario also can come.
And Bay of Bengal is more cyclone prone than the, than the West Coast.
But off late, Arabian Sea is also competing in terms of accelerating.
Started competing with us. So that's why I'm telling
we might have a situation of parallel cyclones simultaneously.
I will come to discuss more elaborately on that. But as you said, that most cyclones are supposed to come, the frequency will increase, the high intensity cyclones. Sanjay, what we are supposed to do?
Well, run. No, Jayanta, I think I would agree with Ramesh. First of all, I would like to congratulate Government of West Bengal for handling the situation so swiftly, knowing the COVID situation, and government has just now come in, has been re-elected. So congratulations, sir, for re-election, and certainly government has demonstrated the leadership role here. What we need to do, I think I would agree with sir on a few things, Jayanta. If you look at Bay of Bengal historically has been warm because of shallow surface and the fact that cool or warm water, fresh water from Ganga and Brahmaputra comes and, you know, falls into Bay of Bengal. That also leads to cyclonic, conditions. So what we need to do is, first, I think let's institutionalize the way we have managed disasters in the last few years. If we look at a super cyclone 1999, 10,000 people dead to Fani, around 70 people dead. I'm basically giving numbers about fatalities, but I think that's an indicator that, how swiftly we are moving in terms of early warning that is helping us in terms of cyclone forecasting, in terms of evacuation relief camps. Sir mentioned about 15,250 relief camps or established 1.5 million people. So save people first and then livelihoods. Livelihood, the way to do it is certainly strengthen infrastructure that supports livelihood, but then most important is how to diversify livelihoods. Of course, it's farm-based. Fisheries is the major source of income, but can we have off-farm activities also, which actually...
So you are basically saying how we can enhance the social resilience.
Yes, saving life doesn't help unless we save livelihoods, because that leads to a slow death for a family then.
So I think that's extremely important. But we keep on talking about these amendments and the physical resilience, but along with the physical resilience, upgrading the social resilience is also a very important thing to do. Extremely important, very important. We need to talk about that. But let's go to Aditi on that point. On the Aditi, what do you feel that how you are being part of this climate change related development work? And I know that in Sundarban area, in other parts of West Bengal, other parts of India and South Asia, the maybe a life saving lost within an hour. So how people should go about it, and what's your suggestion that how we can counter the situation in a better way?
You know, I think we really need to start from the bottom. So far, if you look at disaster, you know, what we've been doing, we say there are 4 R's to disaster risk reduction, right? There's relief and response. Essentially, we've all been focusing on it for far too long, and obviously not enough, because there's so many cyclones that have been happening and they're going to get worse. So relief and response is like a band-aid solution. Obviously, we cannot just restrain ourselves to that. Rehabilitation and restructuring is something what Sanjay has alluded to. But rehabilitation and restructuring is only possible if you look at building a community-based resilience at the local level, looking at it from a medium to long-term resilience, because now we have the science to help us. So we are not looking only at early warning and early action, right? We're not just looking at forecast-based action. We're looking at climate projections. And we're also looking at seasonal forecasts. So we know what's going to really be happening. And as you very rightly said, that, you know, the Met Department science is now has become that we do get a larger window for people to know. Why I'm saying community-based is because when a cyclone strikes you, the first 24, 48, 72 hours, it's the community which has to fend for itself.
Exactly.
Till outside aid arrives. So it's extremely important for the community to be really resilient. How does that happen? So I think what you said right at the beginning is really important. You know, we talk about climate change and we forget about development. We have to talk about climate change and development, and which is where resilience comes in. So if people are more developed, you know, I mean, Sanjay spoke about livelihoods, you spoke about livelihoods. So basically, if you have good health infrastructure, if you have good educational infrastructure, if you have good income possibilities, for which again, what we really need to be doing is something that the, you know, the CDRI, the Coalition on Disaster Resilient Infrastructure, which has just kind of begun, they've kind of included it. I don't know how serious they're going to be. I'm keeping my fingers crossed that they're going to be very serious about it, is what is called blue and green solutions, right? So, or what are also called now nature-based solutions. So okay. Essentially community-based solutions where you try to rehabilitate the infrastructure. My last point, you know, we need to rehabilitate the coral leaves, the mangroves, you know, all those. My last point is that the embankments, you said the embankments got breached. So obviously, you know, villages which thought they were protected within embankments are the ones who are getting flooded. So obviously, I think the engineering approach to resilience is not going to work. So we really need to look at that. And that's where the civil society organizations, you know, Red Cross with its volunteers, it's these people who have to really work to prepare local resilient plans with panchayats, with local panchayats, and make sure that these are the ones which are rehabilitating your natural resources, so that next time a cyclone comes, you know, there's at least the mangroves to hold that back. The reefs are slightly more, you know, better. The livelihoods are kind of taken care of. They may not have food for 12 months, but they will have it for 10 months. That is what we really need to be doing.
Okay. I think extremely valid points. Let's on that point, let's go to Bangladesh. Let's share with the Bangladesh experience. Please unmute yourself, Samsudas Saab. What do you feel? I think Bangladesh is one country whose disaster management, Javed Saab once told me that we need to actually look at Bangladesh to see that how they are doing the disaster management. And if I remember well, Javed Saab, you brought the Bangladesh disaster management minister to West Bengal just to share ideas how we can go about it. I remember that I spoke in that program, so I remember that Javed Saab was there as well. So, what is your Bangladesh preparation for countering this kind of repeated cyclones and disaster? And also, as because the embankment issue has come up, many people in West Bengal are talking about the Netherlands model the polder model that you have in Bangladesh? How successful is the polder model?
Thank you very much. And in fact, this is very complicated discussion and also answer. I would like to refer Aditi and Sanjay in relation to preparedness and also Javed Sahab on the preparedness of Bangladesh. And you rightly mentioned that Bangladesh has some level of preparation on cyclone preparedness. And I should say that this is during and post-disaster response, not rehabilitation, long-term rehabilitation, and also not in terms of build back better, what we are talking right now. So in terms of pre-disaster response, we have standing water on disasters, and we have structures from the top level to the grassroots level, I mean, to the Union Parishad level. So Union Parishad, we have Union Parishad committee, Upazila committee, district level committees, and also farms. So all these structures works automatically when we got warning of any signals of disasters. And accordingly, the government of Bangladesh initiated evacuations. And you know that during this disaster, Bangladesh evacuated around 2 million people. And also allocated some amount of funds, and also prepared around 17,500 volunteers to help evacuation. So this kind of preparedness is excellent, I should say, for Bangladesh. But problem is that after disaster, our response, long-term rehabilitation is not that sound. If I take example from Cyclone Ayla hit Bangladesh in 2007, though we could reduce number of casualties, but still people in the cyclone island affected areas are suffering due to salinity intrusion, water logging, because during that disaster, the water overtopped the infrastructures, I mean the embankment. So embankment is a major concern for cyclone preparedness from Bangladesh. But again, you mentioned that in Bangladesh, there is two types of dimension in discussion. That is techno-physical dimension of resilience building and also socio-economic. Okay. Dimension of resilience building. There is a huge political economy and support for techno-physical resilience building because is investment, is corruption, is many things.
They go in cycle.
But the governance of establishing or implementing techno-physical intervention is not that good. So the embankment is not strong and embankment are not that compact. That's why embankment are turned off during disasters and cyclones.
Okay.
And we are apprehending that disaster hit more in Orissa, not in Bangladesh. Bangladesh only partly affected. But if I consider the level of effect or loss and damages of communities that heals. I mean, here there is a still crisis, as I heard from Tapos Mandal. There's the crisis of water scarcity, food insecurity, and also we are apprehending more diseases. I mean, waterborne diseases in the cyclone affected areas. So we are not prepared for post-disaster rehabilitation activity.
We are not prepared for this post-disaster. I'll come back to you once for the polder, because this polder is now a lot of discussion in West Bengal and India about it. But Tapos, let's very quickly know from you. Tapos Babu, apni jodi ektu apnar unmute koren. Ekta kotha ami bolun to je Ayla je bandh gulo toiri hoyechilo boro bandh Ayla. Shegulo ki ei 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 yasher shomoy shegulo ki bhengeche na shegulo bhangeni.
আমি যে অঞ্চলটায় বেশিরভাগ ঘুরেছি সেটা যদি দেখেন যে আপনি গোসাবা ব্লকের বেশিরভাগ জায়গাতেই আইলার বাঁধ হয়নি, সেই জায়গাটা ভেঙেছে
এবং সেখানটা
ভাঙেনি, কারণ আপনি শিমলগঞ্জ ব্লকে যেটা রায়মঙ্গল নদীর পাশে একদম অপোজিট সুন্দরবন জঙ্গল যেখানটায় হয়েছিল হেমনগর কোস্টাল থানার কাছে, সেই জায়গাটা ঠিকঠাক আছে এবং সেখানে ভাঙার যথেষ্ট সম্ভাবনা ছিল, এর আগে সেটা ভাঙেনি, সেটা টিকে গেছে।
ঠিক আছে, আমি আপনার এই পয়েন্টটা নিয়ে আমি একটু জাভেদ সাহেবের কাছে যাব। জাভেদ সাহেব, what Tapos has just said that because we are talking a lot about this amendments. This is a very key issue since AYALA. Now, what Tapash is saying, that this so-called AYALA amendment that been created, partly with concrete, partly with other things, they more or less stood ground. They stood ground during Amphan, they stood ground during YAS. It might have happened that they have been overtopped by the uprise of the water, but they generally stood their ground. So what's the government of West Bengal thinking about embankment? Because this mangrove is very important. Mangrove barrier, then embankment, and likewise. So any thought about that, Javed Saab, that how we can do this embankments? Chief Minister also had kind of said a task force or a committee to do that. So any thought on that, Javed Saab?
Yeah, definitely. What Tapas has said about the embankment, and embankments are the main, what you call, first layer of security point for us, for the people of Sundarbans and other people. Because if the embankments are okay, then water gushing into the villages and displacement is less. What was previously the engineering was there, that you cannot make any, the environment department has put objection that you cannot make concrete embankments or wall by the side of the embankments. That notion has now changed a little. We can make it mixed with earth and solid concrete and can be mixed and we can make it. But what is happening, you know, as the creeks are there, the rivers are there, the coastal area is there, the surge of water this time was very high. The surge and the volume of velocity of the water was very, very strong.
Very high.
So the whatever embankments we had made, they had somewhere they breached. And not only that, they overtopped the water, overtopped the embankments and came inside the areas, villages and all, and they were flooded. Our Chief Minister last year only, when there was Amphan, we had decided to plant 5 crores mangroves plantation around the Bans in Sundarban area and coastal area. That work is going on, but still it has not completed because the mangroves take time to grow up.
Exactly, so exactly. That's
the more it grows up, you cannot have any effective result or coming something that mangrove is doing some work or not, that it is extending the bath or not, it cannot be said. So this way we are doing it, but definitely new technologies have to be used to strengthen the bonds and the embankments. Otherwise, only putting what you call earth and making the bonds, I don't think it will stay during the storms and the during the cyclone and amphans.
Might be a Sundarban master plan is required where all these factors will be come up and then we can have an actual resilience. People are talking about the local resilience. There is also issue of embankment. So I'll come to back to you to talk about just this master plan on how
our chief minister already formed a task force for it from taking all the line department. The suggestion will come this time. What has to be done to prevent such kind of flooding in future?
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's extremely important. We actually need to talk a bit more on that. But let's go to Dr. Ramesh. Dr. Ramesh, some experts, some meteorological experts were telling me that now the time is up when we need to consider all these extreme parameters together. For example, this particular YAS in the eastern coast, the landfall, the high tide, and everything came together. So they are saying that the comorbidity, also the cofactors of all the variables which can impact the overall scenario. So what's your thought about that? I know that already IMD doing a wonderful job. You are being kind of predicting quite far ahead of the actual thing. But how do you think that we can be further improved so that the government, the ministers like Javed Saab get more time to organize his forces and try to counter? How it can be done, Dr. Ramesh?
See, already last 2 years, significant changes we have made. Cyclone prediction model has atmosphere and as well as the ocean integrated in the prediction system. So ocean energy exchange from the ocean and rapid intensification characteristic is very well captured in the predictions. That's how the landfall accuracies and the intensity characteristics are very well captured in the forecast. But after the cyclone is predicted, landfall is predicted, we are running the storm surge model also. So okay. Storm surge, this time it was very much there, 6-hourly update of storm surge predictions and where the higher volume of water is penetrating into the land and what are the low-lying areas and GIS map is projected, inundations are projected on a GIS map and that is what is done now. It is only 2D, two-dimensional GIS. What now Minister of Earth Sciences institutions are working is to generate coastal three-dimensional GIS. Already for Kadalur and Nagapattinam and some of the districts, 3D GIS is already ready for other district coastal districts that is getting finalized. Data is already there, basic data. You'll have to customize and link other fields like where irrigation is there, where structures are there and all. Once three-dimensional GIS is there for storm surge prediction and where wave action is also incorporated, tidal component is also incorporated, you can clearly see depth of inundation, extent of inundation and street level inundations on 3D GIS.
No, Dr. Ramesh, just to kind of bring this point a bit more. See, Government of West Bengal has data about these amendments and everything. Now, the talk is about the compound events, because even IPCC, you know,
Yes.
Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change, and Sanjay is here, Sanjay can talk about it. IPCC has also started talking about this compound events, that when multiple variables coming together. So IMD has certain areas of prediction, but unless that prediction go hand in hand with the ground-level reality that the government of West Bengal has, the overall picture will not emerge. So don't you think that now the time has come when the this kind of institutions like IMD need to talk more closely with the governments to predict a much more realistic on-ground impact model?
Yes. See, that is what I'm telling. Once the 3D GIS is prepared, then we'll have to go to the state governments, their remote sensing agencies, state remote sensing agencies who have all the details of the coastal topographic features, thematic features with high resolution. That data has to get integrated with our storm surge data. Then only impact, ground level impact of the wind damaging the telecom towers and houses and communication breakdown, communication infrastructure, damage to the crops, damage to the canals, culverts, bridges, and at the same time damage to the embankments and low-lying areas, all that can come. The first, from our side, 3D GIS is getting ready.
I hope more integrated effort between the state governments and the IMD will be seen in future, so that this can be predicted in a much better way.
It will be impact-based forecasting when we work with state governments, state remote sensing centers.
We are our expectation from IMD only getting more and more because you are doing so wonderfully.
No, we are
doing more wonderfully, our expectation getting bigger. So that's the whole point. Sanjay, now when this kind of repeated disaster strikes, and you know better than anyone else that it has immediate impact, short-term impact, the physical impact of being uprooted from your home, being thrown out and like that, and also the long-term impact. So do you feel that this is time when Government of India, along with the very vulnerable states like West Bengal and Orissa, and likewise the coastal states, need to come up with a holistic policy of not only the climate change as general per se, but also this kind of a countering it, the livelihood, the migration and every component. Don't you think that this holistic plan we don't have right now, we need to do that? Sanjay.
Certainly, Jayanta. I think a few years back, I think it was 2019 or 18 when we spoke to Government of India, and we were told that Government of India is working on a national framework on loss and damage that would take into account disasters like cyclones, disasters like drought, floods, and that will also take into account sea level rise and all that. I would suggest one step ahead. I think we certainly need, because we share disasters across boundaries, we need a regional framework on loss and damage that need to be prepared.
Absolutely.
Should also, in addition to coordinating with between Bangladesh, India on Bay of Bengal cyclone and Sri Lanka also, and then drought conditions prevailing between India and Bangladesh, flood between Nepal and India, we certainly need a regional framework on loss and damage, which should also look into how migration is also being induced, because that is also happening within South Asia. So we have to come together, leave aside our political differences. We certainly need to look ourselves as one entity. What Ramesh sir has told is really a great step, because science earlier predicted the impact, but I think the tools that science needs to work on should be able to help us to prepare solutions also. They need to be solution oriented. And if we know the critical infrastructure which is going to get, for example, impacted from storm surge, I think the protection or solutions can be generated already. Now, disaster management is not event based. It is 24/7 because it is happening one after another.
So I think now, in fact, there is always the possibility of, say that expert organizations like yours to join hands with the states and give them inputs. Javed Saab, I think that may be a good idea, that West Bengal is having so many disasters. So take help of these people. Because see, Sundarban people, I have been saying this for the last 10 years, I keep on saying this, that Sundarban, both in India and Bangladesh, virtually contribute nothing to the climate cauldron of the world. They just virtually contribute nothing because they hardly use any energy. But unfortunately, these poor people in Sundarban, in India and Bangladesh, they are the people who are being most impacted. So it's the responsibility of the outer government of the other part of the globe to come and support. So I think the time is up, Sanjay, when I think organizations like yours. Yes, please go ahead.
If I can add, Jayanta, and yes, and in fact, it's other way around. Sundarban as a hotspot with sinking capacities absorbs a lot of carbon dioxide. So it is actually trying to mitigate it, and it's not contributing that one.
Thanks for raising that point. I think it's doing the other around.
Yes, and Can South Asia is already working in few states with state governments. We would certainly like to work in West Bengal also. For example, we are working in Madhya Pradesh for district climate resilient plan in partnership with UNICEF. We are working on how to build capacity at the district level in Sikkim, Madhya Pradesh, and Tamil Nadu on mitigating climate impacts, preparing district practitioners, policy practitioners, and their capacity.
Javed Saab, I think, look forward. Javed Saab, now we may think about actually taking the help of these experts around to do a holistic plan, to a kind of a foolproof plan as far as possible for Sundarban, because Sundarban is a tricky area. It's not really a run-of-the-mill area. It's a completely different area. So, Javed Saab, don't you think that we need to kind of now take this expertise all around?
Definitely, we welcome all expertise, but we have a small problem. We are a state, and Bangladesh is a country, and India has to work, Delhi has to work with Bangladesh, because both sides of the Sundarbans, if we don't work together.
I know that you led that when we had this India-Bangladesh joint effort. And I think at least for the time being, we can start with Indian Sundarban and then actually go to Bangladesh Sundarban.
But hand in hand, we have to work with Bangladesh also. And we have to take all assistance from the new suggestion which is coming from
Perhaps we can really talk about how we can take forward this initiative
forest, irrigation, then disaster and agriculture has to work together to contain this thing. Otherwise, it cannot be. IMD is the main thing which we should take. IMD is doing very well now.
Absolutely.
Fortunately, NGOs do not have that obligation. So we are already working. So let's start with that first.
Okay. Then, Aditi, what's your take on this? This long-term, this disaster strike, there's some immediate issues. But this long-term plan, I know when Amphan struck and now Yas struck, the migration goes more and more, becomes more and more. The trafficking becomes more and more. So how do you see that this peripheral issue sometimes being neglected, not only the physical part of the disaster being talked about? How you see this?
It's actually, I would say, really a double, triple tragedy for the people of Sundarbans. Because Sundarbans, I have done a lot of field work in Sundarbans. It's very, very poor. Which is why I spoke about development. The West Bengal State Action Plan on Climate Change actually has a section on Sundarbans. You know, there was a specific one that was on Sundarbans. Yes, there are plans to, you know, grow mangroves. I mean, from what I know, they grow 2 meters in 2 years, which is good enough, you know. So, but you can't grow mangroves, you know, the state can't come and just grow mangroves. You have to work with the people there. So I would really say that when we are really looking at long term, there are several issues. Sanjay mentioned displacement. I think if I may call them climate refugees, those are really growing. Unfortunately, we are talking about interboundary, you know, issues on Sundarbans. There are no laws about these. There are no laws about internally displaced people who may be coming in from Sundarbans in the same country or people across borders. There are no laws. So that's something that governments are kind of now beginning to talk about, but okay. That needs to move much faster.
Okay.
Also,
okay.
The fact that there are some platforms where I think the civil society needs to engage much more actively than it's been doing. You know, we've been talking about the global frameworks of the Paris Agreement and, you know, whatever. But absolutely. Really, it's the Asian Ministerial Conference, for instance, on disaster risk reduction, which is what we really need to be talking about. Because there, if we can, you know, put it in those ANCDRR documents, like the East Asia has done, for instance, where across boundaries, states, countries have agreed to work together. RIMES is already working together as far as IMD goes. So it's, you know, already so in the Himalayas.
Those platforms.
Yeah, we are sharing data on the, between Nepal absolutely. And, you know, India on the early warning. So those things are happening. So I think there are some platforms where we
some platforms are available.
Much more
some platforms are available.
Where the state governments also need to engage much more. Right now, it's a central government.
Perhaps the people like Sanjay and people like you who can actually kind of share those inputs with the governments so that they are kind of open to those ideas that how can they maximize and have the leverage of doing of utilizing whatever resources being available. Great. Dua bhai. So to you, again, that same question, because this question I keep on hearing, polder. How the polders are doing in Bangladesh? Javasav is also interested to know how the polders are doing in Bangladesh.
Yes, thank you. In fact, the polders were built in 1960s to facilitate agricultural activities and to protect agricultural land from saline water. But the polders are not working right now because the height of tidal surge have increased. So the polders cannot stop water coming in. This is one problem. Another problem is polders include sluice gate for water regulation. I mean, water structures. Many of the water structures are not functioning. So if the water structures do not function, then the sluice gate and embankment and we rather call them, they're trapped to the situation. So the polders and embankment is not the only solution to a complex problem. We also think about other solution. I mean, socio-economic adaptation, social safety net, expand of social safety net and supporting them, planned relocation. And planned relocation is in fact, depending on distribution of trust land. I mean, you know about trust land, government land. The government land is occupied by the influential for productive activities. So we have laws for distributing cash loan to the to the landless people or uprooted people, but this is not working. So if we cannot work on entire governance system, then we not be able to address this huge problem. So it's not a one-shot solution. The solution should be comprehensive and solution should be integrated and entire governance system should be tied up to those solutions.
Okay, very quick, I have around 10 minutes, I have to go for another round. Very quick response from you. I went to Bangladesh Sundarban sometimes, and I went to actually Khulna and Mongla and inside, say areas like Joymulla Khali and all. And there I find that people are quite sensitive to the disaster situation. So they're saying that whenever the flag, one, two or three flag, and we run towards the disaster shelters, apparently, the people in Bangladesh Sundarban are apparently more kind of sensitive to the disaster situation and they are more compliant. In West Bengal, despite the best effort of the government, this time a lot of people went, but generally around 30-40% kind of refused to go. They feel that their houses will be looted or something of that happened. So you feel that there's more role of NGOs? Is the non-profit organizations working there kind of triggering more awareness and action with the people? Or is it due to the fact there are more cyclones that people are generally being aware? What's your take on that? What's the role of non-government institutions in Bangladesh?
In fact, the role of non-government institution is very significant in Bangladesh since history. If you see the history, it's the non-government organization that first came to the situation to aware people, train them up on the signaling system, and also a kind of force them or motivate them to leave the places, unsafe places. So the awareness raising activities, training, if you go to the Sundarban areas, and I think you visited, you'll find many NGOs, national NGOs, international NGOs, they have been working there since many years. So before that, I mean, if you consider 10 years back, all the NGOs work for training, capacity building, awareness raising. Now NGOs came with many intervention like ensuring safe water and also health system, integrated livelihood development. So the role of NGOs have changed, but if you consider a decade back, NGOs' role in capacity building and awareness raising was significant.
Very important. I'll come to that, Sanjay, for the last minute. Before that, to Dr. Ramesh. Dr. Ramesh, again, IMD's prediction. Now you are working in such a wonderful modeling and all that. What kind of coordination you have with the, say, the countries around? Because when a cyclone is generated, sometimes it's generated in the other country or something. So what is the level of coordination of IMD, maybe with the neighboring countries like Bangladesh or Sri Lanka or Maldives or whatever? What is the situation kind of overall?
IMD has a very close service level partnership with all the nations adjoining Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea put together. So it is IMD is in fact responsible to give warnings for all the extreme weather phenomena originating from the open sea areas in the Bay of Bengal and Indian Ocean Rim. We call it as Indian Ocean Rim countries. So traditionally under the umbrella of World Meteorological Organization, this partnership has been built and it is getting nurtured, and annually all the countries meet also put together. That's how the naming of the cyclones is a combination of names given by all of them in an alphabetical order. Cyclone names are given in the Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal. So that partnership is very strong, and with more and more frequency intensity of cyclones are happening, that is growing.
Okay.
Recently we have implemented something called flash flood guidance system covering India, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. So
overall,
running that system, that is the most successful one.
We hope that it will be more and more functional with time. Javed Saab, before I ask you the question, let me share with all of you a small thing. But Dr. Ramesh told me, I keep on talking with him during the entire period of YAS, and he was actually educating me on the several issues. So he said that the speed of YAS got reduced by about 30 kilometers. If you look at the, I'm just sharing with all of you, if you look at the IMD was doing hour to hour kind of predictions, and I saw 11:45 p.m. on 25th night, the IMD was predicting the maximum speed will be 185 kilometers per hour. And 3 o'clock in the morning, I was checking throughout, 3 o'clock in the morning, the prediction changed to 155 kilometers per hour. So actually the speed of the cyclone got reduced by 30 kilometers. And in the morning, I suddenly noticed that. And in the morning, in fact, that was never in any media. Nobody picked it up. So I asked Dr. Ramesh why it happened. Has it happened? He said, yes, it has happened. Well, why it has happened? He said that as because the cyclone got in a point in the landfall, which is a narrow shelf. If I am wrong, Dr. Ramesh, please correct me. It's a narrow shelf and the shallow shelf, and the energy is less in the sea. So it could not take adequate energy from the from the sea and could not be as strong as it was initially predicted. Am I right, Dr. Ramesh? Am I right?
It is a curved geometry of the coastline between...
The landfall geometry. So the landfall geometry actually has stopped stronger damage. If it would have been in a more open sea, it could have been more devastating. So thanks God, thanks all gods that it has happened. So with that, Javed Saab, coming to you, one point repeatedly being talked by Sanjay, Duhabhai and Aditi and all, is about the resilience by the local people. You know better than anybody else that Sundarban is such a challenging area to reach. So when there is this high tides and everything, even you cannot go closer by boat. So the initial resilience has to come from the people themselves. So there is an issue of community resilience. And I personally feel, being in Sundarban for so many years, I think there's a case for upgrading the capacity of the local panchayats. And that is an extremely key thing to do, because Sundarban panchayats are not like the panchayats in other parts of Bengal. So any thought about how you can increase the local level resilience in Sundarban in future? Javed Saab.
Yeah, definitely. We are working on it and it has come to our notice also. We have to take into confidence the local stakeholders. Otherwise, if we don't prepare the stakeholders, whatever we do, it cannot reach them. So, we have to do it there itself. The awareness has to be created. Local restructuring of amenities has to be done. Otherwise, like there are houses which are of thatch and other thing. If it is near the coastal area, if you can remove a little bit and build a house with bricks and all that, it will help in overcoming damage and displacement of people. So we have to think about it. The local infrastructure has to be developed. Roads, the hospitals, the primary rural health base has to be developed. Moreover, the stakeholders should be trained how to combat cyclone and how to combat floods. Both has different dimension. In floods, there are different kind of issues, like snake bite is there. In cyclone, the trees are uprooting, walls is falling, evacuation is there. So different thing has to, we have to prepare them. And more or less, first of all, we have to prepare a plan, long term and short term. What is we are going to do in short term, what is has to be done, and long term, what has to be done. And if we do it with all the agencies, all the line departments, then definitely we can come up with a solution where damage will be less and replacement, displacement will be less.
In fact, you started the process. Let me also share that this time I was told by the local people that even before the cyclone, I think you supplied the tarpaulins and other things in the various panchayats so that they could get it very quickly after the disaster. So that is a very good step to start up, actually. You supply to the various areas.
We are already taking care of that only. We have made multiple cyclone sheds also there, gudowns also there. Then we have flood shelters also there. In north, south Chobis Purgana, we have multiple, purpose cyclone shelter around 150 in one district. And we have flood shelter 20. So we are upgrading the thing. We have grounds where we store all the relief material in advance. Or we deploy the men in advance with the boats when there is a signal of flood and all that. We get the reports that this year it will be more flooded and all that. We take care of it. Like in cyclone also, we not only work alone, we work with 21 line departments. The irrigation is there, then we have the electricity. Department with us, We have the PWD with us. We have a health department with us. Everyone is working in tandem. So how to minimize the difficulties? But it has to reach to the ground level.
Absolutely. That is the key point. It has to reach to the ground level. I just have a quick question to Doha Bhai, and then I'll to Adityan, and I wind then Sanjay, and I wind up with Tapash. The final situation in Sundarban. I can see that Sundarban is getting dark and darker. I hope only the sun will rise stronger tomorrow morning. But Doha Bhai, that this whole issue of community resilience. I just would like to know that. How much you feel it has acted on ground, or does it really make a difference? Because sometimes we theorize something, but it doesn't operate on ground. But this community resilience, does it work on ground in Bangladesh? Very quickly, we are kind of running out of time.
If I say very quickly, community resilience is working, but this is not sustainable. Sustainable in that sense, because they are just coping. I mean, if I consider the climate change adaptation, this is just DRR plus. So we are not considering the long-term problem or long-term projection. So if I tell you that in the Sundarban areas or in the southern part of the country, there's a huge problem of water. So people are collecting water from the surface sources. But the government department, I mean, DPHE, who is responsible for supplying water, they still are supplying deep tube well. So deep tube well are just if you deep tube well, they are coming saline water, not the fresh water. So the entire governance system should be localized.
Governance system, I think very key, yes. Extremely key. Aditi, governance system, whatever you do with the community, end of the day, the governance, the local level governance is extremely important. So don't you think that this need to be also kind of, there should be a capacity development, something of the governance system, to work on this, to counter this kind of disaster, Aditi?
Absolutely. I think what we need to do is we need to bring together three things. We need to bring together science. And when I say science, I'm not talking only about weather alerts and weather warnings. I'm talking about climate projections. Today, climate projections can be told to local people that this is what to expect. Earlier, we couldn't, but today we could. So one is science. The second thing is policies. Definitely, we need to have enabling policies. They have to start at the top. And, you know, really, it's a state governments and the central government who, you know, like, I think it's very important what you said about Bangladesh, that, you know, the whole way of which you're actually governing the water system needs to change, right? Just like we've changed in renewable energy, right? We've changed the way we used to govern it. We need to do the same thing. So policies, enabling policies, if I may put it like that, are extremely important. And the last thing is practice, where you have your local level task forces, your local level panchayats, your local level resilience, all these
things. They need to be together. Absolutely. Sanjay, final word. That, see, we can talk about this long range issues and all that, but Sundarban in India has 5 million people, more people than many European countries. And these people are in extreme distress. So really, you cannot think about what's going to happen in 2050. We need to find a solution by 2030, by 2025. So what's your, globally, these agendas, looking at a local issue of Sundarban, how you feel that Sundarban should go about it, government of West Bengal can go about it, or even Bangladesh can go about it. What's your prescription, very quickly?
Janta, I think the most important part of Sundarban is not only 5 million people, but how many million people it protects from its biodiversity hotspot. I think that importance needs to be highlighted. In my opinion, it's time to go for local planning. As Aditi said, science, policy, and practice. It's important that we go for local planning. We engage civil society throughout the year. Whenever disaster struck, governance comes in, because the issue that you ask about community-based practice and good governance ensures sustainability to community-based practices. So, and that is what we need to, unfold in Sundarbans.
Okay, and I have my comment on that. I end up with that, but Tapash, if you can unmute yourself, Tapash, you have to unmute. Korun. সুন্দরবনের মানুষ হিসেবে আপনার কি এখানে এখানে বিভিন্ন এক্সপার্টরা রয়েছেন, মাননীয় মন্ত্রী রয়েছেন, আমি শর্ট টার্ম বেনিফিটের কথা বলছি না, সেটা এখন আপনার খাবার দরকার, মেডিকেল ক্যাম্প দরকার, মাথার উপর ছাদ দরকার, এগুলো দরকার, বাঁধ ঠিক করা দরকার, কিন্তু সুন্দরবনকে সুন্দরবনকে বেঁচে থাকতে গেলে আপনার কি মনে হয় যে কি আপনাদের কি চাহিদা, কি বহির্বিশ্বের কাছে আপনাদের চাহিদা কি?
বহির্বিশ্বের কাছে আমাদের চাহিদা যদি বলতে হয় এবং মাননীয় মন্ত্রীর কাছে, যে আমাদের যে ম্যানগ্রোভ লাগানোর যে বিষয়টা চলছে সেটা ভয়ঙ্কর ভাবে আরো বেড়ে করা উচিত। যদি জায়গা না থাকে জায়গা নিয়ে সেটা করা উচিত, বাঁধগুলোকে আগে ঠিক করা উচিত এবং লোকাল রেজিলিয়েন্স বিল্ড আপের জন্য একটা টাস্কফোর্স গঠন করা উচিত, যেটা নিয়ে কথা হচ্ছিল। এবং অবশ্যই সাইক্লোন সেন্টার প্রত্যেকটা এলাকাতে সাইক্লোন সেন্টার বাড়ানো উচিত। যেমন কুমিনবাড়ি জিপিতে আমি বলতে পারি মাননীয় মন্ত্রী সাহেব আছেন, যে কুমিনবাড়ি ব্লকে কুমিনবাড়ি জিপিতে আছেন 4,000 ফ্যামিলি, 4,200 ফ্যামিলি, প্রায় 22,000 লোক, দুটো সাইক্লোন সেন্টার, এবং সেটা একটা জায়গা থেকে আরেকটা যাওয়ার, মানে প্রত্যেকটা জায়গাতেই আমাদের বেশিরভাগ এই টাইগার প্রজেক্ট এলাকার অপোজিট গুলো যে আইল্যান্ড গুলো সেখানে সাইক্লোন সেন্টারের একটা থেকে আরেকটা দূরত্ব অনেকটা বেশি। আরেকটা জিনিস আমি বারবার বলতে চাইবো, যেহেতু গভর্নমেন্টের পয়সাতে এখানে নানা ছোটখাটো ঘর হচ্ছে এবং পাকা ঘর হচ্ছে, তো একটা করে ঘর অন্তত সেখানে থাকা উচিত পাকা এবং ছাদ দেয়া, যারা অন্তত আমরা ঝড়গুলোকে তো আটকাতে পারবো না, মানুষগুলোকে অন্তত তারা নিজেদের লাইভলিহুডের যে জিনিসপত্র সেগুলো নিয়ে অন্তত একটা পাকা জায়গায় তাদের নিজের জিনিসপত্র নিয়ে থাকতে পারে। বহির্বিশ্ব এবং মাননীয় মন্ত্রী যারা এই বিষয়গুলো যারা এক্সপার্ট, তারা এই বিষয়গুলো কিভাবে দেখবেন সেটা তাদের ব্যাপার। আমাদের এই দাবিগুলো রইল, এগুলো যদি হয় আমার মনে হয় কিছুটা অন্তত মানুষ সুস্থ থাকতে পারবে।
Do not understand Bengali. What Tapas is saying, I asked him, what's your demand from the outer world? He's saying that number one is mangrove, mangrove and mangrove. Because mangrove, we all know, is extremely important. আমি এখানে তাপসবাবুকে জিজ্ঞাসা করবো, অনেকে বলেন যে মানুষ জমি দিতে চায় না, আপনার কি মনে হয় এটা ঘটনা, যদি সত্যি সত্যি বাদ দেওয়া হয় মানুষ জমি দেবে না?
আমি একটা অভিজ্ঞতার কথা বলি, আমি পরশুদিন যখন মাননীয় প্রধান এবং উপপ্রধানের সঙ্গে আমি নদীর পাশে গিয়েছিলাম, তো সেখানে যখন ওই নদীর বাঁধের কাছে গেলাম, সেখানে লোকজন বলছে, মাননীয় প্রধানকে বলছেন যে আপনাদের যা জমি লাগে যা লাগে নিন, কিন্তু আপনি বাঁধটাকে তৈরি করুন, ডিজাস্টার যখন সময় তৈরি হয় তখন মানুষ জমা জমিতে তৈরি হবে।
So what Tapas is saying very shortly in a nutshell, number one, mangrove, mangrove and mangrove, and he's saying for kind of planting mangrove and doing the embankment properly, land is not an issue. There is a myth going around that people don't want to give land. I know people have resistant to the land, but I have my personal experience where people have written letter to our administrator that we would like to give the land, please build the embankment here. So sometimes people do not have the confidence in local level executives, so they may not be giving the land. But as because it's a matter of death and life, they definitely will give land if they are having the credible alternative. So that's number one he's saying. And another is a very important, Javed Sahab is there, we will discussing it later as well, is that he's saying, it's also my theory, I keep on saying this, that at least one room in a house should have a pakka chhad, should have a proper roof, a pakka roof, so that even if there is a disaster, the family can actually gather within that room and save themselves and also their processes. Because during years we saw that the lives have been saved thanks to the Javed Sahab's and the government of West Bengal's effort, but the livelihoods could not be saved. Even the Honorable Chief Minister has said that about 20,000 crores of Indian rupees have been lost. So my point is, these are the two points he's saying. One is mangrove and embankment. Land is there, people would like to give land. And second is, at least one room with pakka roof. That is, I think, an extremely important... Aditi, very quickly, very quickly. Very quickly,
mangroves, 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 because people's livelihoods are linked to it.
So,
and fresh water is linked to it.
Sure,
so it's really important.
Okay. Javed Sahab, I wanted to finish it up, but as because Tapas has raised this point, we'll be discussing it later, that I think it's a very interesting theory that if we can have one room, which is having a higher plinth, I am adding to what Tapas said, not only a pakka roof, but a raised room with a upraised plinth, that could save a lot of people, a lot of lives, not only lives, a lot of people and livelihoods. So any thought that maybe in future we can think on this line, Javed Sahab?
Yes, we are thinking on it, definitely. But what we are doing now at present, we are retrofitting all the government properties with such facilities, like the schools, the panchayat places, the grounds where they are. We are trying to refit it, and more flood shelters has to be built, more cyclone shelters has to be built, and
for example, Kumilwadi has only two flood shelters. Kumilwadi has two flood shelters. So if we can have more there.
We'll also, for relief material, there is no doubt the local administration, the panchayat, they are there to provide all the relief material. There is no, what do you call, deficiency in relief. There is nothing.
So what you are suggesting that the local administration in Kumilwadi, they should write to the government that we need more flood shelters and there will be no doubt of money to doing it.
Yeah, definitely. We are also already in the process building it.
Tapos, you can hear. Tapos, you have to pressurize your local administration, write letter to the honorable minister, to the government, saying that we are only having it. Kumilwadi is incidentally one of the last islands before Bangladesh. So it's extremely in a precarious position. So definitely the people in Kumilwadi deserve more disaster shelters. Not only two, more than two, maybe four, maybe five. So you must be writing to the ministers. Unless you write and raise the demand from the people, nothing will happen. Nothing will happen. So you have to raise the demand. You have to take confidence of your Panchayat Pradhan, your institutions, and you have to do that. So I think, thankfully, with this coordination today, Kumilwadi will have more disaster shelters in future.
Thank you.
I will end up with this as my understanding from this discussion. It's a fabulous discussion we raised. We talked about 1 hour, 10 minutes almost now. Is that in a disaster management, there are four kinds of situation. One is IMD, what predicting is. I think IMD has almost reached its perfection level. It may go even better, but already IMD is doing a fabulous job. So IMD is already there. Regional government, the state government, as we understood from the Javed Saab, that with the prediction from IMD, they are doing this evacuation and everything. And as because government of West Bengal this time could evacuate 1.5 million people and saved lives, only 1% died from Yas in West Bengal. In contrast, in the other cyclone in Arabian coast, more than 170 people died. So I think that's something very good. All the states are doing it. Not only West Bengal, every state is doing it. So the regional perfection has also reached to a certain level. But what remains to be desired still is the local level action and the local level governance. So the panchayats, local institutions, local non-profits, local people, they need to get their act together, make the local level plan, as Sanjay was talking about, local level plan, share that with the government and take help of the IMDs for the prediction point of view. Maybe we'll be having a different and a bit of a better future for Sundarban despite having more cyclones. With that note, thanking everybody for your time, we wind up today. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you.